system, we will go with the sense organs and the endocrine system. That is the whole unit for the, if you study brain or something like this. Okay? So we will be doing these chapters. Then after that, we will be following circulatory and excretory and all that. So.
And Miss, the new reduced syllabus has come, which has further reduced reproductive system from our syllabus. It is not coming.
Okay, fine. Means right now it is being given?
Yes, Miss, right now.
Okay, just after the class, just when you are free with your other classes, just give that detail to me. I will just see to it what we have to do.
Okay, Miss.
Okay, Ayush, joined? Oh, good morning.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Fine. So, you don't have the school right now?
No, ma'am. From tomorrow onwards, it will start.
Okay, okay, fine. So, both of you had your exams?
Yes, Miss. Biology exams are over.
Over? Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I also.
The question was all right.
Okay.
Somewhat tricky also, Miss.
Yes, ma'am. Fine. Question was very easy.
Okay, fine. So just send that question paper to me if you have it, that in your phone.
Yes,
I don't know it.
Email, because we gave it in Google Form, so I can send it to you in email only.
Okay, email. I will just forward my email ID after the class.
Okay,
to you.
Thank you. Okay. I will.
Okay.
Give you the question.
Okay, fine. Yeah, yeah, sure. And you have to write down the paper or you have to do?
50 marks of MCQ.
Only online it was?
Yes, miss, online.
Okay, okay, fine.
Writing part will start, miss, from 1st October.
Okay.
So we are having 50 marks of MCQ and 30 marks of subjective writing. That will start.
Okay. For you also, Ayush?
No, my... Only 80 exams paper. 80 marks.
Okay. 80 marks. Okay. Full yes. MCQ.
No, ma'am.
Okay.
Subjective.
Full subjective.
Full subjective. Okay. Fine. So, see, we will
ma'am,
start.
I sent you the question paper.
Okay, already. Fine. Good. I will not disturb the screen right now because if I do that, I will get fumbled with this. Two, three apps. So, see this. We will begin with the nervous system then.
Yes, miss.
Okay. And it's quite interesting when you study about human physiology. I think it is much more interesting than plants. Because plants are also good to study, but sometimes they feel like we, when you go for the theoretical part, it is sometimes you can't imagine literally, because you can't see that in the plants or something like that. It goes in the imaginary line sometimes. So, but with the human, it is not the case. You can feel that because being human, we know that what is happening inside our body. So it is good with the nervous system when we are studying. So let's see that when we are talking about nervous system, first of all, we have as for the humans, it has been classified in different categories. And when you are seeing that if detailed part of nervous system, then brain, spinal cord and all that we are studying. So we have the whole control in our body just because of brain. And definitely as the brain is the part of your body which is utilizing the major available energy in your body. It will be surprising to you that whatever glucose, the basic source of energy you are having in your diet, out of the whatever energy is being produced from 100%, almost more than 50% is being utilized by brain, because that is how much active it is. And it is active even when you are sleeping, even when you are resting, even when if you are doing something, then it is working definitely. But when you are resting, when you are not doing anything, metabolically very silent, then also the brain is the one which is working at different levels. And definitely you may come across with different words and all that, different terms that you must have heard or read in other books. Now, not basically following your textbooks or something like that. If you have such type of words in your mind, just do ask me. I will, because when you are studying brain, a lot of other questions will pop up in your mind also. Okay, so see this first of all, that how it is being categorized first. So it is divided into the whole nervous system is being divided into two major portions, and that is called central nervous system, that is CNS, if you talk about, and you have the one that is the peripheral nervous system. Okay. So that is PNS. So these are the two major classification, that is how we are dividing the this one. And central and peripheral. Central means the one which is centrally located on the central axis, and peripheral, that means spreaded all over the body to justify with all the stimulus which is being produced in the body or which is being received. So that is how it is being divided into two parts. Then you have further classification for central and peripheral also. So let's see for the central, first of all, you have the further classification that is called brain. And then you have the other one that is spinal cord. We all are aware of these terms because these are not something which is coming up for the first time in our books. So we will be detailing out how it is being should be studied. Then only it will be fascinating sometimes when you are studying it in details. So brain and spinal cord are the part of central nervous system. And brain is majorly further divided into three regions, that is cerebrum, then you have cerebellum, and then you have one that is called medulla oblongata. So these are the three portions of our brain, cerebrum, cerebellum, and medulla oblongata, and they are playing a very important and major role because any part of these three regions, if it is getting injured, then definitely it will give our body a very drastic result, which can be visualized, which can be observed, or which can be seen physically. Okay, so these three regions are the major one, and I think because as we are aware of Hindi movies and all that, so you must have heard about that chota dimag, bada dimag. I don't know, these types of terms is being utilized for. So, because if somebody hits above the neck on the back side of your head, in the movies we have seen, don't hit the chota dimag because it will get disturbed. Okay, so These cerebrum and cerebellum are the one, these chota and bada and all that. Okay, and we will come across with this when we are going the details for that. And this is how brain is being classified. Now, then we have the spinal cord. Spinal cord have different region, different types of sections. I think you are in ninth standard. You have the skeletal system of your body as your
yes,
chapter.
Yes, we had it.
You had it, na? So, just after, if you have that book with you, just in a, when you are free with your exams and all that, because when you are reading about the spinal cord and all that, just go through the skeletal system along with it. It will give you a much better idea and much better view for this chapter. So just have that reference also. Then you have peripheral nervous system. Peripheral nervous system is included with all the nerves and all that. What is being spreaded in your body, that is peripheral nervous system. And we have two types for that. That is called, the first one is somatic peripheral nervous system. While another one is autonomic. So, autonomic nervous system. Okay. So, for that also, I think these types of terms is being utilized, SNS, PNS, autonomic nervous system. So, somatic and autonomic nervous system, when you will read that, you will understand that these two systems are working parallelly and in correlation with each other, that how they will give you the response and how they will judge all the stimulus and all that. Okay. So, somatic nervous system is all about the one which we talk about, like nerves basically arising from the brain and the spinal cord. So, it has two types of classification, that is, first one, the all the nerves which are arising from the cranium, that is cranial nerves, okay, arising from the cranium. Cranium means brain box. Okay, so
yes, we had it in class 9, skeletal.
Yes, because these terms will be following that part only.
Yes,
so cranial means cranium, that is your brain box where your brain is located. So the nerves arising from that region, they are called cranial nerves. And then you have the spinal nerves, the one which is arising from the spinal cord. Okay. So cranial nerves have a good number. You have to memorize the number, because if you are going for the medical studies further, this one is a very important one. The cranial nerves are 12 pairs, while spinal nerves are 31 pairs of the nerves. Okay. So these because they are in pairs, because we have left and right side of our body, so they are in pairs. Okay, so 12 pairs and 31 pairs are there, and further they have lot of classification. I will just give you the view for it, that cranial nerves are further classified into three categories. They are sensory, then you have motor, and then you have next. So this is how it is being divided, sensory, motor, and mixed. And then you have the spinal nerves. They are also divided in your body with the exact number they are having, like in neck region they are being classified. Then you have thorax after that. Okay. Then you have the one that is called lumbar. And then you have the one that is called coccygeal region. I will just give you the revision for these terms. Neck, you have some, I think 8 pairs you are having. Then in thorax, you are having 12 pairs. While lumbar, you are having around 5
or something like that it was.
Yes, 5. 5 pairs, and then you have one over here. Okay, so for the coccygeal. So this is how it is being divided, and they have some type of classification further also, but we will see if your book suggests me to go further with this, then we will proceed. Otherwise, we will be limiting that factor over there only. Okay, so neck. Thorax means the one which is, because we are talking about the spinal, that is on the back side. The one which is on the, exactly on the back side of your chest, that is thorax region. And lumbar, that is your waist region, where you tie your belt or where you tie your pant, that region is called lumbar. And below that, if you go towards the hips, and on the lower portion, that is called coccygeal region. Okay, so this is how it is being divided. Okay, and these numbers, if you go according to the skeletal system, it will give you a good relation with the number of the bones. So that is why I told you that just go through that chapter also after this. Okay, then you have autonomic nervous system. Okay, and it is being divided into two parts, that is called sympathetic and parasympathetic. Okay, so sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system. These two systems, because in our body, if we say we have the control section, we have a control unit which controls or regulates everything, like the frequency of every organ or organ system. Like if we talk about frequency, then frequency relates to, let me give you one example, that we have a counted number of heartbeat for a minute. That means for it beats like our heartbeats for 70 to 72 beats per minute it is giving us. Okay, that it should not go lower than it, and it should not rise. It should not cross that maximum limit also. Okay. Yes, plus minus 10 is okay, fine. It doesn't make any difference. But if we say that 40 beats per minute, then it's a dangerous sign. And if I say 100 beats per minute, then also it's a dangerous sign. So minimum maximum limit has to be maintained. You can go for any thing, like if we say the amount of glucose, amount of creatinine, amount of uric acid, amount of anything, n number of things, if we say, all these things are being controlled by sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. And if you read in detail, then you will come across that sympathetic nervous system is the one which stimulates. That means it increases the thing. While parasympathetic is the one which gives you the calming effect. That means it lower down the thing. So that is how they work in opposition with each other, and it controls the whole system of our body. But in detail, if you read, it is not compulsory. Okay, it is not a thumb rule that only parasympathetic will do the calming effect and sympathetic will do the stimulant. It is not the thumb rule for each and everything for our body. There may be some changes in some areas, okay? But that is how it goes. It stimulates the thing, it calms down the thing. So that is how they are working. And if we talk about its location, where it is being there, so if we talk about between your neck region, okay, and your waist, till your waist, or this sympathetic nervous system is being controlling the things, while parasympathetic nervous system is being located, that means above the neck and below the waist. So that is how it is being located. Just remember that part. And below the waist, we will you may have the terms like sacrum unit or something like that. So if you are remembering the sacral bones or something, yes, like that. Okay, so sacral is the one which is located on the lower side of your body, that is around your
coccyx.
Yes, coccyx, and it is forming a good structure of a triangular bone is there, and yes, it allows you to sit properly. Okay, that is the it gives you the base when we sit. So this is where the sacral bones are present. Okay, so below the sacrum, whatever is being controlled, that is by parasympathetic unit. Okay, so this is how it is being desired, the whole nervous system. Let's see how much detail we can give to this. Anything to be asked in this region?
No, Miss, it's clear.
Okay. Ayush?
No, Miss.
Okay. So let's see further. So with this, we will talk about, then we will read about the whole unit of the nervous system, that is called neuron or a nerve cell. Then we will proceed with the brain and all that. Okay. And so first, when we are talking about neuron, let's, I think I should introduce these words as they are being discussed in your book also. That is called stimulus. Then you have the word that is called response. And you have the word impulse. So there is a difference between stimulus, response, and impulse that we will study along with this neuron structure. And neuron is the one. Is the unit of our nervous system, that is nerve cell. The longest cell of the body, that is nerve cell. I think all these things come in the lower classes. Yeah, that is the longest one, and it have the length almost sometimes even more than 1 meter also. So that how long it can be. So and it is having a good network inside our body, all over the body it is there. And they are considered as very fast transmitting unit. And the way it is being designed, that is responsible for the this particular transmission. So let's see that it is having three major portions, that is called cyton. Okay, and then you have dendrons and axons. Okay, so three major portions of these nerve cells are there. So this cyton, or you can use the word for it a cell body. Okay, and in some book you may come across the word called perikaryon. Something like that may also be there. Okay, peri means that is being surrounding, and karyon means the nucleus. Surrounding the nucleus, if something is present, then it is called cell body, cyton, or perikaryon. Karyon means nucleus. Okay, and just understand that this particular cyton is having all the cell organelles the way other cells are having. They are also having all the cells organelles in them, except the ability to divide. That means centrosomes. If I don't know, you have read the cell division portion in detail or not, but there is a term called centrosome, which gives the ability to the cell to divide. That means, I think you are aware of this chromosomes and all that.
Okay? Yes, please.
And the central one is called centrosome. Okay. And okay, so wherever this particular structure is present, that cell is bind to divide further. But this is not present in this particular nerve cell. That is why we say that once the nerve cells are being formed, when you are born, that means when it is being decided that you are going to be developed in your mother's body, and the whole system is being formed when the particular zygote is formed, and zygote is dividing, having reaching to the particular size and number of cells it is obtaining, and the modified type of cells will decide to form the nervous system of your body. At that time only it is being judged, or it is being the whole body will form the whole each and every nerve cell. And once it is being done, and once you are being delivered, then no nerve cell being formed further. Okay. This is why the nervous system is very important, because once it is being formed, then it is finally it is all done. It will not be like other cells that if you get injured or something like that, it will get replaced, or nothing can be done for that. So this is what is very important for the nerve cell, that they don't divide. Okay, and this particular cyton is having all the cell organelles along with the nucleus, and it's have a cytoplasm. Okay, that is called neuroplasm. If some terms like this may come across, cytoplasm is called neuroplasm in that. Okay, that neuroplasm is very much granulated. That means it's not a smooth viscous fluid. It has some granules in it. And why is it so? That the reason for charging and all that, it gives an electrified effect and all that. So that is why it is being granulated. And then you have the dendrons. Dendrons means a huge number of branches that is arising from this cell body. Okay, so that is called dendrons or projections. We will use the term that is called projections. And another one is called the axon, which is the one extended projection coming out of this cell body. It is a very long one, and it is from one cell body only one axon is arising. this is how this system is being organized, basically. Then Exxon may have some different branches. There may be the possibility, okay? But from one cell body, basically, only one Exxon is arising. So we will talk, see this structure, first of all, that how it is being designed. So we have a nucleus, and from that we have branches, something like this. If you see, they are very random, no particular type of length is something is not there. It is being like this only. Okay. So if I go for this one, fine. So this a particular region is called cyton. Okay. And this is having a cytoplasm that is called neuroplasm. Okay. And it have a nucleus in it. So this is the region is called cell body, and it gives out many projections from it. These are called dendrites. And they have dendrite endings and all that. So this is how it is being, dendrons are there present, of coming so in huge number, they are coming out of the cell body. Okay. And these dendrites are responsible for receiving the whatever signals are coming. Okay. So whatever is coming, they are just at the receiving end. They will just receive the signals. They will give it to the this particular cell body, and it is being that how the computer works. That means where RAM and all that is present in the computer. So whatever input you are giving, all everything is being processed over there. Then it gives you the output. So that is what being is done over here. These dendrons will receive. The processing will be done over here. Then it will be further forwarded to this extension that is called exon. We will be reading its structure in detail, because this one is a very important unit. Okay, and because of this one, there are two types of nerve fibers you will be seeing. Okay, so just see to it that when we are talking about these three terms, stimulus, response, and impulse. See to this that if I say like below the skin, if I'm pinching right now, so I am giving the stimulus over here. Okay, and the stimulus is being received below the skin. The units like this of the dendrons and are present, and these they will just receive this particular signal. Then they will pass to the cell body wherever it is there, and it will be then further extended to the towards the brain, or if it is related to the spinal cord, then it will go there, over there. So that is how it is being working. And these are just like the plugs. You have the plugs in the machine at the end of the wire. That is how they are present below the skin. They are just have these endings below the skin, the epidermal tissue, and they will receive the stimulus from that particular sense organ. And the response, whatever is being is developed, that we will talk about when we discuss about exon, that how it is being reaching. And impulse is the one that when you are receiving the stimulus, one type of electrified current is being produced in our nervous system. That that electric wave or that sudden change in the this particular region, that is called impulse. So let's see further that how these nerve fibers are being classified. We have two types of nerve fibers, that is medullated and non-medullated. Okay, so we will talk about medullated first of all, so it will be giving you much clearer idea. So the one which is having the extended projection, that is called axon area. This axon area is covered by a fatty layer, just like the packets at some intervals. And I think you must be aware that fat is a bad conductor of electricity. I think you are aware of this.
Yes, miss.
Okay. So what is happening? This particular projection is covered with the fatty layer that is called myelin sheath. This is called myelin sheath, and this myelin sheath is just like this. Suppose if this is an axon and I am covering it like this, okay, after some interval another myelin sheath is present. So there will be a gap in between these two intervals, and whatever I am drawing right now, it is over this region also. That means on the from upper side also it is covering. Whatever we are drawing is a two-dimensional structure. Okay, so I can show you on this side also, but it is like this. If this is an axon, it is all over the surrounding, it is being covering like this, it is holding this particular axon. Okay, so this is what the myelin sheath is there. Then this myelin sheath is have a one thin layer over it. Just like you have lamination on your documents, that is how this particular thin layer is covering this whole region. Okay, so this is how this is covering, and this particular thin layer is called neurilemma or neurolemma. These types of words you may can read. So myelin sheath is covered by the neurilemma, and the gap one which is present in between is called node of Ranvier. Okay, so node of Ranvier is present over here. So this is how it is being designed. And in some non-medullated axons or non-medullated nerve fibers, if we talk, so if these myelin sheath and neurilemma are not present, so they are called non-medullated nerve fibers. But the medullated one is a very extensively present in our body. All over it is required, and the percentage of its presence is also more in our body. So that is why we are concentrating on medullated nerve fiber. And this nerve fiber, when it ends at the, whenever it is ending, it do have the branches like this. So this is how it will be having. These are called axon endings. So wherever the axon is ending, so after that you have another cell, this particular nerve cell with the dendrons waiting for it. Okay, I will be drawing something like this. So, So you have dendrons over here. Okay. So wherever the axon is ending, you have the another nerve cell after it present at the end, and they will be working for channeling the whole impulse. Okay. So whatever is being processed over here, that should be transmitted through this channel and it should reach over here. Whenever it is reaching here, it should be passed further with the another to the another nerve cell having the dendrons at this end. Okay, so wherever the axon endings are there, after that, if you see, you have another nerve cell with the dendron endings following it. Okay, so this region is very important for transmission of nerve impulse and all that. If synapses. Yes, synapse. Okay, so let me magnify this particular axon ending. If I magnify this region, you can see that it's a bulb-like unit. Something like that is over here. That means if I magnify, you can see bulbs over here. Okay. This is how they are formed. So if we magnify, you can see a bulb-like portion over here. And this gap is called synaptic gaps, or you can use the word called synapse. Okay, so this is called synaptic gap. Cleft. Yes, Rina?
Miss, synaptic cleft, miss that term?
Yeah. You can use the word cleft also.
Yes,
miss. Okay, cleft, gap, or synapse, anything can be utilized. And these bulbs are called synaptic bulbs. Okay. So,
ma'am, what are synaptic endings?
These only, bulbs only.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So, now see, okay, fine. Let's see how it is working, how the stimulus response and impulse are doing their things, that we will see. So, as I said, that whatever you are receiving, that is called stimulus. Anything, not only on your skin, whatever you are smelling, if you are tasting something, because our tongue is also a sense organ, our eyes are also a sense organ, our nose is a sense organ, you are hearing something, your ears are sense organs. Okay. So, whatever you are receiving from the sense organs, that should be received by dendrons. And they should be present wherever the receiving ends are there. They should be present over there just in the form of a plug. The way we have a switch on the switchboard, that is how they are being attached over there. And wherever they will be receiving, the whole information is being processed over here. And then it should be traveling this particular region. It should reach over there. And these synaptic bulbs are responsible for passing the information to the other dendrites present after these axon endings. Now see, suppose right now if some information is coming down to this end and it reaches to the synaptic bulb, okay? And it's a big process. Many chemical changes occur in this. And once this is done, then you have a neurotransmitter. I think you must have heard about the word this neurotransmitter. Okay, it's a chemical. Neurotransmitter, I think the one which is very common or general, that is called acetylcholine. I think you have heard about it.
Yes, Ms. Acetylcholine.
Okay. So, there are two other types of neurotransmitters also. But this one is the one it is being very common. That is why we are using that one, acetylcholine and all that. So, this neurotransmitter is not, basically, it is not present over here. So, whenever the information is coming and it is reaching to the synaptic bulb, then this gap, the particular synaptic gap or cleft or synapse, will be filled with neurotransmitter suddenly, and just like a river, it is being filled with this particular chemical, this fluid, and this whole region wherever these gaps are there, it is being filled with this particular chemical. And these impulse, because right now whatever it is traveling, it is in form of electrical formation. So this electrical formation will just pass through this particular neurotransmitter, and it will be received by these dendrites. Once this information is being passed over to the dendrites, then this neurotransmitter will be released, or it will be degenerated from this region. Okay, so these gaps are all not always filled with this particular chemical. They are just filled whenever there is a response, or whenever the impulse is coming to this particular region. Otherwise, it will be empty. Understood this?
Yes, miss. Miss, okay. then, yes? Is it called jumping of impulses?
I am coming to it, because we are reading medullated ulna fiber, basically what happens, that why we are having such fast response is coming whenever you are receiving something, or we have the tendency to give out any physical response or something in mentally also. Sometimes we control our emotions, that we don't have to do this, or we don't have to show this type of action in front of all these people. But mentally we are working on it. So that is how it is working, that all depends on this particular transmission of impulses. Okay. So how it is jumping? Because there is a electrochemical change. What is happening over here is particularly all electrochemical change, because here it is all works electrically, then here the chemical comes, then many things are being changed and it is being traveled over here, then it again converts into the electrical form. So that's why it is called electrochemical transmission. So now see that if you have a medullated nerve fiber, and we have the node of Ranvier's over here. So what is happening, that suppose, let me give you one example, that if you, both of you are sitting with each other in one room, and no teacher is there, and you are playing or doing something, whatever you are wishing to. Okay. So apart from studies, just think about of the classroom. What happens when the teacher is not there? Okay. So we do everything. We climb the bench. We run on the bench. We run on the passages between the benches and all that. Whatever students can do. All these things are not required, but we do. We all have done. Even I have done when I was a student. Okay. So it was not a big thing. So what happens that, at that time our nervous system is very much relaxed, and it is working on that. So whatever transmission impulse is going through this, it is just continuously it is traveling. But suddenly, if you hear the voice of some teacher or some authority outside the classroom, then you know what you have to do. Either you have to disappear from that place, or you have to be very much disciplined. You have to show what you have to do, that you are not doing anything wrong. Okay. So let's talk about this response first of all. Let's suppose if Ayush pinches you, okay, then what you will do? You will just hit him or slap him, or shout on him. That is what you do. But if suddenly, if I am standing in front of you and I take your hand, anybody of you, either I use hand or your Udayan hand in my I just hold it and pinch it. Will you slap me?
No, miss.
Okay. So that justification, that processing has to be done over here. That what you have to do, because it is reaching to the brain, it is deciding and all that. A sudden response when you have to give, that is very, how quick it can be. You can just imagine that if you are sleeping and if you have a sibling at your home, and your sibling just come into the room and throw a pillow on your face, then what you will do? You will just throw it back, or you will shout loud on him or her. Okay, so how quick response you can give, how quick activity comes up, it depends completely on the on the situation, or it depends completely on the person who is standing in front of you. That particular decision and all that, all these things are done by these nervous system. So see this, whenever these impulses are being traveling over here through medullated nerve fiber, because impulse, suppose if I hold a coffee mug and I give it to you, and you don't know it is hot, cold, whatever, what is inside it, you don't know. You just hold it and you feel the heat. You just leave it. In a fraction of a second, you will give me the response. So see this, these medullated nerve fibers, they have that much tendency that the speed of the impulse is so fast that because of these myelin sheath. What happens that whenever these impulse is traveling over here, it will jump from one node to another. Okay, it will just have that the way of traveling. Suppose if I write down, draw like this, and these are the nodes. So this impulse will just have a jump from one node to another. So that is why this is how fast it is reaching over there. Okay, and if we talk about the response, that is also coming in form, in this form only. So thanks to this medullated nerve fibers, so they are working so fast on it. Okay, so if these are non-medullated nerve fibers, then definitely this particular transmission will be following this particular whole route. They will not jump. Okay, but impulse has to jump. How it is jumping, why it is jumping, that you don't have to worry. But this is how from one node to another they will jump, and that is why the response is so fast. Okay, so this is how it is being done. And in this region also, it is just like if we say like a boat is sailing through the river, that is how this impulse will be sailing through this region. So this, whenever the neurotransmitter is being released in this region, this information will be divided into small parts, and they will be received by dendrons. Then they will again will be accumulated in one gathered form, and it will be traveling further. So that is how the transmission of nerve impulses is occurring. Understood this?
Yes, miss.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So medullated nerve fibers are doing this, and what is happening with this region, we will see that transmission is all about the electrical and chemical process, as I said. So let me write down that if I draw this nerve fiber over here, okay, it is all on the presence of the charges present on these nerve fibers. So basically, when you are resting, no type of activity is there in the external environment or near your sensory organ. Then these nerve fiber, when they are resting, they have positive charge outside this particular nerve fiber on both the side, all over. Because we are talking about something like this. So all over this particular nerve fiber, positive charge will be there. Okay, and inside it will have the negative one. Okay, inside it you have the negative one. So this positive charge outside this nerve fiber, it is just because of presence of sodium ions, and huge number of sodium ions are responsible for this positive charge. And you will be surprised that this negative charge is not because of something, some negative ion is present. I am just giving you a hint that it is present because low number of K plus ions are there. The number is very low, lower inside. So that is why it is negative inside. You will be asking me that, ma'am, K, because potassium is the one which is carrying a positive charge. Okay, then how can it be negative? It's all a number game because sodium outside is present in a very huge number, and this one is in very lower number, it's very less number it is present. So that is why inside it is negative and outside it is positive. If you, we will read this muscles and all that, you will come across the word called sodium potassium pump. Okay, so this word I am just giving you because that is because your book is reading to that detail, but it is not giving the explanation. Okay, so that is why I am just giving you the hint for this. You don't have to worry because after you reach to the higher class, definitely the details will come to you. Just hold on. Okay, so let's see. Okay, fine. So potassium ion, sodium ion are having a more number outside. That is why it is positively charged. Okay, and you will read some book may give you sodium potassium pump, this word. Okay, this pump is working, and that is why these positive negative differences there. Now, what happens that this is the resting condition of the nerve fiber. And suppose if you give the stimulus, suppose if I touch, if you have a skin over here, okay, and if I touch in this region, I'm providing you the stimulus, then what will happen that this particular region will suddenly diffuse all the sodium ions inside this particular nerve fiber. And inside it will become positive. I'm writing on both the side because it is happening all over the region. Okay, that's why I'm writing on both the side. So, outside it will become negative. Because at this region, you have received that particular sense or stimulus. So that is how it will happen. So this particular region will get interchange the charges. And rest of the nerve fiber will be same. This it will have the positive outside. Yeah. While negative inside. This is how it will be doing it. So wherever this change of the charge is occurring, this particular region, we will say, this much region is depolarized. Okay, it will get depolarized. Depolarized state will occur, and this response, because this stimulus has, because once you have mechanical sensor sense you have received, it will be this, when this is happening, it will be converting itself into the electrical form, and this electric, because it is, you know that electricity travels in the form of wave. So whenever it is traveling further, so further what will happen? Slowly these charges will interchange, and the small region of it will be depolarized along with the traveling of this particular impulse. Understood this?
Yes, miss.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so that is how it is happening. And again, if I go for this, so if this impulse has traveled further, then again it will be like this. It will be regaining its posture, and This is how it is traveled. Okay, in the nerve fiber. So when we talk about the medullated one, this depolarization is happening at the node of Ranvier's. So that is how it is fastly it is being traveling over this, and this state is called, as we know, this is the depolarized one, and because it has regained, then it is called repolarized. While this one is the one which is the resting. Understood this?
Yes, miss.
This is polarized, or I can use the word resting also for this. Anything can be utilized. Polarized is the state when the nerve fiber is in the resting state. Okay, so that is how repolarization and depolarization, then this is when it is happening. This can lead to the transmission of nerve impulse in the nerve fiber. And it is all because of interconversion of sodium potassium ions. Understood this?
Yes, miss.
Okay, fine. So this is how it is being done. Now, just I am giving you one hint for importance of sodium over here. You must have seen the people who are fasting, especially the women's who are fasting without for the whole day, for 24 hours, like without water, without eating anything. You must have seen that they feel a bit dizzy after some time. They feels very low on lower side because this sodium is very much important for these nerve fiber. And when you are not having the salt in your diet, then this is being disturbed. That's why your body loses the strength. That's why your body loses the strength, and the person will feel like falling down or feel dizzy or something like that happens to that particular. Yeah, or you can imagine this situation that suppose you have not had your breakfast and you skip your lunch suddenly and you don't have a particular type of salty food in your diet. Suppose for 12 to 14 hours continuously you don't have that. Then you must have, or in the days of the summer, if you are traveling in open environment and all that, do you feel a bit low or something like that happens?
Yes, miss, a bit of dizziness is observed.
Yes, dizziness is there. You feel like you don't have a strength in your body. You feel like sitting at one place, don't talk with anybody, something like that happens.
School assembly only.
Yeah, school assembly. Many of the children just fall down. They don't have their breakfast, basically, that especially the girls. And that is how they are at that time. You can just have imagination of this. This sodium is losing its concentration. And that is because it is present in the nerve fiber, that is how important it should be present in the brain also, the sodium. So once it is not there, all these things will occur inside the body. Understood this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes,
ma'am. So that is how it is happening. And we have 10 minutes. Okay, fine. So let's see about the reflex arc with this. So once you are aware of this particular transmission of nerve impulse and all that, let me talk about that, how it is giving you the response, how it is forming a channel. That means, suppose if we talk about the skin, okay, because it is the major sense organ present all over the body. and it is receiving the impulse, that is, it is receiving the stimulus. Okay, the stimulus is being received by skin. I will be drawing something like this. This is the dermal layers, and below that you have these dendron units. These are present. These dendrons are present. Then they will be carrying forward the impulse through cell body, and this cell body will be giving it out through axon, ending. It is there. Okay. So after this, you have dendrites, synapse and all that is there. Then you have another cell body. Then through this axon, it is coming up, and axon ending is there. You have another particular, if nerve cell is there, let me see this. I just don't know how. That will make you confused. So just to see to it that skin is the one, is the receiving one, the stimulus. Once it is being received by dendrons, then it should be processed over here in the cyton. It should travel along these axon, and axon ending it should reach. Then in the synapse, it should be for processed, means travel further to another dendrites. Then it will be received by the dendrons, and then it is being judged over here. Then it should be further traveled to the, again through the sense organ, that what you have to do or whatever related is there. So see, let me give you that in between this region, these nerve fibers, they have different types of channels of nerve fibers, which is giving the response to the brain. And the brain will be the deciding these things, that what you have to do. That suppose if you are holding something hot, then you have to, it will give the signal to the muscles of your hands to release that mug. And if it is soothing, then you have to hold it for a longer duration, or you have to do that particular thing you have to do it, or you have to release that thing. That is being decided by brain. And this response will be given to the this particular another nerve fiber, and it will go to the organ wherever it is being responsible. Now see that this, why I am writing organ, that suppose if insect is biting you, then your brain will give a response to your hand that remove that particular insect suddenly. Okay. So it will go to the your hand. But suppose if your father is holding your ear, and that stimulus will be going through this nerve fiber, it will reach to the brain, and brain will decide, okay, it's your, the one who is holding the brain, the one who is giving you this stimulus is a dad. So for the father, what type of response should be given? That means your hand should be not working at that time. Your eyes should be down. Your tears must be rolling out sometimes. That may be the possibility. Or nothing like that may happen. But that type of response will be given to the organ, that you don't have to move your hands at that time. So that is how the brain will decide. And this whole channel is called reflex arc. Is it clear to you?
Yes, miss, it is.
Okay. So I'm not good with the diagrams with this type of. So just sorry for it. Okay. But this is how it is working. The type of response, what you have to do, is all being decided by brain over here. But the process, information, some processing of these information is also done over in these cyton or cell body also. Is it clear to you?
Yes, miss.
That is what about the reflex arc. You can just go through this thing, and if whatever reference book you are having, just read to it. If you have some new word which you don't understand, you can ask me in the next class.
Okay, miss.
So we will do this next class. We will study brain. And I will show you some good pictures of the brain apart from your textbook, so that you can have a good idea for it also.
Okay, miss. Thank you.
Bye. Okay, have a good day.
Same to you, miss.
And all the best if you are having exams or something like that.
Yes, miss. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.